hands together as I welcome on stage architect Sourabh Gupta. A huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
So, thanks for keeping people awake. I'll try my two bits for the next 20 minutes. So, hi everybody. So, I thought it was a very confronting topic to speak on. It's usually good to speak on design, explain your projects, generally lighter and easier for me. But when I saw this, I think this was more as a reflection for myself that yes, at our own level, I was saying that when I started, I was looking at this fairly confronting topic. I was that yes, this looks confronting, but as you reflect, I think you, in your subconscious, start working around multiple things, and so this whole entrepreneurial bit of it also gets into the picture. And that's really where I thought I'll work with this today. So as an architect, we design and build. We're constantly doing that. Now, I think where an opportunity or a responsibility comes is here, that you have to not just design and build buildings, products, you need to start designing and building a lot of relationships. You're in a position where, as an architect, you understand society at one on one side. I'm not audible?
So, yeah. So I said, we need to design not just buildings, but really build trust, work around clients, but also have this massive obligation of working in societies. So to me, from the very beginning, it was about designing and building all of it together, the hardware and the software to it. And I think that's where the whole journey kind of transcends from just being a designer, just being an architect, to being an entrepreneur as well. So just to give you an example on this, we won a competition for an international center in Lucknow. And once we won the competition and looked at everything, of course, we had a task of working next to a massive stone park, next to a river, but with a context which was very dense. And so we started responding to it in our own way, and not just architecturally, but at a larger goal. So the first thing that really started was that, hey, where are the trees? You know, so there were just no trees out here, and we've got a site which was built around a forest. So getting the whole green back as a gesture, not just as a built, but as a gesture at a larger level, was really important for us. And then we looked at creating a program. It's from the first time probably that we were looking at actually creating a different program after having won a competition, won a project, which was now about to start. So we actually scooped out a small space from the building and kind of built it out, and we created a new museum. So this was an international center. For some reason, it was being called the Jayaprakash Narayan International Center. And so we actually took up the opportunity of saying, let's make it an experience center, a museum, a public space, which was larger. And that's how this project really started. And that's when, you know, from a very base project, it became a multi-layered project through the greens and the forest coming up and so on and so forth into multiple functions. We could actually play with functions as well. I think that's where fundamentally a lot of us, a lot of architects work with, that they question the program and they rework on the program. I always feel that looking at a city, looking at an urban context, you're far more have an understanding of what program could fit in best in a particular project. And so, you know, it was trying to vertically put together a large sports center, a convention center, and a hotel kind of stacked on top of each other. So they were really like three buildings working together. And then it really became a journey of building something which was for the city, was very clean, very modern for a city like Lucknow, which had all the imambaras and everything around it. It had all the complexities of layers of today's architecture and building, but kind of trying to take it to the next level, to bring in every bit of technology. So you had a massive building, which was then covered with a berm, making it sustainable, making it ecological, environmental. And so that's really the journey. So to me, it was really a statement to be able to bring in a public function into a competition that started with the function of a sports facility, and that could really suddenly become a public facility. So now this sports facility became a convention center, and the gateway that was extracted out really became a museum, a public space, which is quite active in Lucknow. So that's really how I put it together, that for us, it's quite important that we have to be able to play a larger role. we have to go beyond our contract, beyond our obligation of building the best way that we can build. That's where we need to question the base. And that's where I think the entrepreneur really comes in. So I just structured a few realities that we work in at Archohm, and through some anecdotal experiences, share with you what we think we do, and it seems to be working. So as a DNA, I think incredible optimism. You need that even as an architect now. You don't even need to go beyond. In India, if you need to work, and if you need to work in public space, I think you have to fundamentally be an extremely positive person. And that really has to be in everything. So I remember life had taken me to Bombay on multiple projects. We were constantly looking at the city and how the city's skyline has to work, how the city's public space needs to work. We did a lot of competitions. We kept on working on a city with very little to understand because I was coming from Delhi. And soon, then about, when I'm saying soon, in public space, it's almost like 2 years. After stitching everything together, we could get all the agencies together to then start building a value, a kind of a image of the Mumbai metros. And finally, I think all the Mumbai metro networks will have a common language and kind of stitch through. And this is, I think last month, this has been launched. The first stations are up, and I think now things move on. So you need incredible patience to be able to pull these things through. Connecting the dots. I think that's this 5 degrees of separation. This is quite important. A very interesting story to it. So this is Archohm, and this blurred image I just took from a flight myself. This is a mosque right next to my office, and the imam would always invite all these national leaders to keep coming in. And so the leader of a very big part of the Muslim sect, Mr. Madni, actually happened to be in the mosque. Being in the mosque, probably at a certain height, he saw the building. Seeing the building, he walks in. Walking in, he could see the energy, and before we knew, we were working with him on multiple projects. It's how relationships as conversations start and kind of keep moving on. And you know, then we've been building institutions for them. Not only that, we got so engrossed into the institutions, we started becoming a part of that pedagogy itself. We started looking at how things should be working in an institute, so much to starting with understanding of an Islam of the more liberal level that could work in India. That was the real institute about. And so not just the building, not just its attitude, it was more even at the education level. As architects, we kind of got completely soaked in, coming up with a book, now working on more models. The book was even launched at a great platform. And so how it kind of just keeps flowing on. So you need to sometimes just keep going, and the dots do connect. Yeah, I think, again, nothing special, but yes, you need to just keep going out of your way to keep doing things. You don't need to necessarily know the end to be able to make these starts, and I think that's really the message. And I still remember we were told to start working on an area around Taj Mahal, and the detailed design, it was more like an engineering project that started with saying, okay, you've got Taj Mahal in the center, these are the roads that move around it, fix the water supply, fix the sewage line, fix the basic electricals because we need to declutter. We got the project. The first thing I did was got the engineering of the main project sideways out of my way. And we said, let's first get the urban controls in place. We first started with the identity of Agra. So it was really a chaos at that level to even ask the client to say, okay, we're not really just fixing your sewage system. Let's first fix the mind. Let's first come up with the base of what we want to do with Agra. And then we started working on the landscape, the pedestrian, the larger signage storytelling, all the kinds of various facilities. And soon, with probably 20% of the budget of the larger project, which was really underground, one could actually start working and changing and embedding a complete identity and complete space all around Taj Mahal. Of course, in 70 years, nothing had been attempted before. This was the first attempt, their priority to get the cabling in, but nobody had thought through what has to be done on top. Even a simple change like changing the black top to a red stone, which would then be permanent to make a cobbled space to go to this beautiful white monument, was a task we had to fight up to Supreme Court. There were 11 owners to the project. So, you know, you just had to go crazy way, way, way beyond what your design thought. And so this was a very extreme reality that we had. So, but of course, then when it starts moving, I think people start coming together, things start moving well. The most important, I would say, part of learning and the part of your path getting defined is actually the failures and not the successes. I mean, I think I can write a book on that. The number of projects, the dead ends, the lost competitions, the lost opportunities, and you know, there's no end to that. So I think reflecting on that really, really helps. We had a very short three and a half years of crazy amount of work in the Middle East, in Libya. We were practically building parts of cities, building mosques, understanding the culture, the environment, everything looking pretty, everything at a mid-level, and suddenly Libya collapsed. I think that was the day I was almost at the verge that Archohm collapsed, because it was a massive, massive problem for us. We were a small office, suddenly exploding, putting all our effort into one space, not being able to say no to this massive volume and scale, and then practically one fine day it was a task even pulling our people out of that country back. Tens of such stories. I think all it did was probably gave us a list of learnings and we moved on. So to me, I think the failures were almost as important or more. 24/7, that's easy. That's our home, that's in our blood. So, you know, we have our own studio, which is practically 24/7. To add to the madness, it's always literally working at some level or the other. The place, of course, but also the what kind of work goes on. So from interiors to product to experience to urban to all kinds of faculty, you know, from living there to playing and sleeping. I think that place is an ecosystem in itself. So that really helps. That also helps you grow. That also keeps you going. No to no. This is probably the funniest reality through a project. So we won Dilli Heart when Archohm was 5 years old in 2005. It was probably a project where I thought, this is, to me, in my personal journey, a kind of a position or a plateau where I feel, yes, okay, I have started my practice as an architect. So Dilli Heart was big. We had dreams. We won this competition. But the journey started with crazy pain. It took us 9 years to do the project. We were awarded a project in a year. In 2 years, the DPR got prepared. Commonwealth made the project stop. Something else happens. The contractor changes. Finally, there is a foundation ceremony. The project gets completed. The project opens to public in 2014. And today, 2019, I still don't have a completion certificate of the project. That's the reality, 15 years. So, you know, it's, I wrote a letter once the project was completed, I remember, because there were a series of project architects who had given it all they had. And I still know them. I still know they're all around, some of them in the office, some not. And these, everything in an architect's life has to be linked. And you know, when you shift project from people to people, people you experience, all of you, a lot of you experience this, it's a pain. But it's when you just want to build something because it needs to get done. This made no sense, no business sense, definitely no entrepreneurial sense at that point, and nothing. But when the project gets consumed, when it gets used by people, when it gets validated in public, I think that's what makes you, you know, do what you do. QED, again, always questioning the norm, always questioning what you set out to be. So we met Mr. Bachchan through a series of museums we were doing, and then he asked us to design his identity, his signature. Now, designing his identity is almost impossible. So what we did is what we basically started with the first principle, and we started designing his paper. So he's somebody who keeps writing letters to everybody. So we designed his paper from his roots of Allahabad, took the sands to the absolute across the globe, to a beautiful little town in Italy where all the paper for Michelangelo's of the world was made, made that paper, brought it back for him, and that was really the identity. So it was really about questioning anything and everything that you were set out to do. Yeah, so that's begging for wisdom, borrowing a lot of experience, stealing a lot of time, and killing a lot of egos. I have this embedded in concrete in my room, and it's always so provoking because people just don't understand it. And then it's always a conversation starter. But the point is, you need to do this. I think we've got enough dreamers in our country. The doers is what it takes. So for us, it's very important to be able to see the projects get the light of the day when they are done. again, Husainabad, the old city of Lucknow. I was really inspired when Delhi Metro started in Old Delhi. So I had this dream of what all can be done. We were given a small part of Lucknow to fix, and we completely revamped it. The entire old city became this one massive park connecting 11 monuments. That was impossible had we thought ourselves as architects who could give drawings and go for site vision. I had to put teams sitting there 24/7, practically doing every job in the value chain, from getting the file sanctioned to the construction detailed and done, because you don't get to do that. You don't get to do that too often, and that's your city's at stake. So choosing your battles in Lucknow, in Tajganj, we had a big plot of land we saw, and that could have had a museum. So we made a point or a case to do the Agra Museum. We, at that time, brought in David Chipperfield, who had just finished their big Berlin Noise Museum, and we worked with them and got the project going. And now you have one of the finest buildings, I think, coming up in Agra soon as a museum, pretty much next to Taj Mahal. Yeah, this is what I do all the time. When in doubt, I just go for it, because you know, this, you start at the bottom, it's not a problem. So looking at getting good staff, looking at having good people to work with, I always knew is a challenge. So I think we jumped in, not just with the idea of starting design education, but also at looking at space. See, we got a curriculum together, got a bunch of people together, took up an old Katha factory, we had no money, rented a space, and we started a design school. It's just been three and a half years now, but it's a beginning and it's beautiful, because the space tells you to move ahead, to do things out of the box, and the curriculum does that, and hopefully, these things would work. Yeah. So I think that's the give and take of an architect and entrepreneur, that you have to constantly shuttle between the two, almost not realizing which role to play when. But I think it gives us a great position in the larger piece of the puzzle, that we can manage things well as an architect. The owner always wants to talk on that. You need to be grounded to the last worker, things like that. So just the last few slides of a journey to kind of tie this up. The planned growth is actually just various plans of our offices as we grew along the way. We are 19 years now. Started Incept. I always call them my temples. Did my master's in the Netherlands. Before I could complete, we got this opportunity to do D&D, the toll plazas there. Luckily, they were on the river, so they were not in UP or in Delhi, so I did not have to be an architect to do that. So the building got done, we moved on. That's where life started as Archohm was born. In 2000, moved into our own little domain, did our 5 years of celebration. At every step, I was celebrating life. And on 5 years, the next year onwards, we started this series of tours, taking the entire office to some part of the world, celebrating architecture. Starting a furniture studio, which could then celebrate design and bring back design back to India in a strong way. 2010, started looking at construction management a little bit, because your projects would just never see the construction quality you ever wanted. Got our own office building in 10 years. That was a big turning point. Came out with our first book in a year or so after that. Built about 100 toll plazas. Design factory happened in 2012. One of the most beautiful babies, I would say, for Archohm, because we're doing museums, we are putting culture back in its place and really helping around and completely coming full circle on design from architecture to product to experience. Having our sub offices in various cities, to the education about 5 years back. Having a small studio, which started GoMads with all the concrete collection, more products, celebrating something we love. Got to do something around Taj Mahal, of course, which was huge. Started teaching at the Dessau School at Bauhaus, which was very reflective, which also gave me the confidence to start an education institute back here. Started a design travel for people like yourselves, so everybody could go to curated travel tours. 2017, Mr. Bachchan happened in 18, I'm a big fan. And built an India Pavilion in France last year, 2018. So life has been good. Life has been very good. And I can only say that I don't think I run a practice like an entrepreneur, but I definitely can do everything as an architect because of the attitude I've had. So really, if I look at what entrepreneurs are, I think a failed entrepreneur can definitely do decent work at architecture. And what we can do is maybe not profit, but creating a fair bit of value. Thank you very much.